Hi everyone, and welcome to lecture 3 of number theory and cryptography. In this one, we investigate classical encryption schemes which do not really use number theory. In practice, those methods are not used anymore because of serious security flaws, but we will see that they are very useful for our educational purposes. In this first part, we will explore one of the oldest classical encryption methods, which is the Caesar Cipher, and we will see that it is very easy to code break. Before we do so, let us define what encryption means. As you can see on the screen, Alice and Bob want to communicate securely through an insecure channel. However, Eve, who's in the middle, flatters, squabbles, and deceives. She is willing to do anything to intercept the information exchanged by Alice and Bob. Our channel is not secure, so we might assume that every message exchanged by Alice and Bob is also received by Eve. Therefore, the original question raised by cryptography is, how can Alice and Bob communicate securely without Eve learning anything from the messages? In order to prevent her from understanding the conversation, Alice and Bob use an encryption scheme like the one you can see on the screen. Roughly speaking, Alice encrypts the original message M, which we call the plain text, using an encryption function which we denote E. The result of this encryption is called the ciphertext C. The word cipher is derived from the Arabic word cipher, which means zero, or in other terms, nothing. Now, instead of sending the plain text to Bob, Alice sends him the ciphertext. When Bob receives it, he decrypts it using a decryption algorithm denoted D. Generally, and for reasons that we will encounter in future lectures, the encryption and decryption functions are public and in particular known to attackers. Therefore, in order to do the conversation, Alice and Bob has to find a way to share a secret key hidden from Eve. In this manner, and without the knowledge of the secret key, when she receives the ciphertext C, Eve will not be able to decrypt it. This scheme obviously and roughly describes real-world applications, such that sending emails, transactions between a customer and a merchant, a customer and his bank, but it also applies to storing data. Let us now get back to our main topic, which is the Caesar Cipher. Did Julius Caesar really pronounce the famous encrypted sentence that you see here? Indeed, His Highness used to communicate with his armies using an encryption scheme based on shifting all the letters of the alphabet by 3. So as you can see here, A becomes D, B becomes E, C becomes F, and so on and so forth. But the problem with this presentation is that we exceed the alphabet as soon as we get to X. So in order to solve this, we wrap around and consider that the letter following Z is A, so X is corresponding to A, and Y is corresponding to B, and Z is corresponding to C. Therefore, a better way to represent this is to draw both of the alphabets on a circle, as you can see on the screen. Now, I hope that you can see that the Caesar cipher is very easy to decrypt because it is sufficient to shift the alphabet by 3 in the reverse order, and the famous Caesar code is alia iacta est, which in English gives the die is cast. Notice actually that there is nothing special by shifting by 3 and that we can shift by any number. Now, one important question is to know in how many ways one can encrypt messages using the Caesar cipher. The answer to this is obviously 26. Indeed, one can see, for instance, that wrapping around by 2 or wrapping around by 28 gives the same encryption. One can also see that turning this wheel by 54 gives also the same encryption. This is mainly because 54 is 2 times 26 plus 2, which means that we turn the wheel twice to get back where we started, and then we shift by 2. In the same fashion, shifting the alphabet by 5, for instance, is the same thing as shifting the alphabet by 31, or even by 57, and this is mainly because 57 is 2 times 26 plus 5, which also means that we turn around the wheel twice to end up by shifting the alphabet by 5. Now, in order to use some mathematics, and because it is easier to manipulate numbers than letters, we replace letters by numbers, as you can see on the screen. We assign 0 to the letter A, 1 to the letter B, 2 to the letter C, and so on and so forth. Now, imagine we would like to encrypt the word math. The first thing to do is to convert letters to numbers. We see on our table that M is 12, A is 0, T is 19, and H is 7. Once this is done, we add a 3 to each of the numbers to get here 15, 3, 22, and 10. Now, in order to get the ciphertext, all we have to do is to convert back our numbers to letters, in which case we see that 15 is B, 3 is D, 22 corresponds to W, and 10 corresponds to K. Notice that we can also shift the alphabet by 5, for instance, to get here 17, 5, 24, and 12. which yields the ciphertext RFYM. We notice here that our plain text is still math, but encrypted in two different ways. In order to do decryption, all we need is to give our recipient how much to subtract. This is what we call the key. In the first case, we subtract 3, and in the second case, we have to subtract 5. Notice here that we can encrypt the word math in 25 different ways, actually 26 different ways, but shifting the alphabet by 0 does not encrypt anything at all. Let us now encrypt the message crypto is great. The first thing to do is to convert letters to numbers and then add 3 to each of them. Now, one problem that we see here, the number 27 does not correspond to any letter of the alphabet. So if you convert back numbers to letters, what should we put in front of 27? Notice first that 27 is 2 letters past 25, which corresponds to the end of the alphabet. By wrapping around by 2 places, we see like before that actually 27 and 1 stand for the same letter, which is the letter B. Does this remind you of something familiar that we do on a daily basis? Actually, this is exactly the way we do arithmetic on a 12-hour clock. Indeed, what time will it be 4 hours after 11 o'clock? The answer is 15, but instead of saying 15, we usually say 3 o'clock. In the same fashion, 8 hours after 10 o'clock is 18 o'clock, but we usually say 6 o'clock as well. Now we see that the Caesar cipher corresponds to a 26 hours clock, in which 26 is 0. For instance, if you do a shift by 11, the letter U here will correspond to 20 plus 11, which is 31, which actually corresponds to the letter F, because 5 is the same thing as 31 on a 26-hour clock. This is mainly because 31 is 26 plus 5, and we say actually that 31 is congruent or equivalent to 5 on a 26-hour clock, and we say that 31 is congruent to 5 modulo 26. More generally, we say that X and Y are equivalent modulo 26 if X and Y point to the same hour on our clock, which is equivalent to the fact that X is equal to Y plus an integer K times 26. This means that we wrap around our clock K times and then add a Y. For instance, one can see that 134 and 82 are equivalent modulo 26, and this is mainly because 134 minus 82 is 2 times 26. You can verify this very easily, and one can verify that both of them are equivalent actually to 4 modulo 26. So 134 is equivalent to 82, which is equivalent to 4 modulo 26. Notice one nice feature on the clock is that we can add and subtract numbers like the real numbers. For instance, we have 28 plus 29 is equivalent to 2 plus 3 modulo 26. Actually, this is true because 2 is equivalent to 28 and 29 is the same hour as 3, so we get here something equivalent to 5 modulo 26. Notice that we could also go backward on our clock, and for instance, we see that minus 4 is the same thing as 22 modulo 26, and this is mainly because minus 4 is equal to 22 plus minus 1 times 26. So going backward by 4 is the same thing as going forward by 22, because we turn the wheel backward once and then add 22 to get minus 4. Representing integers on a clock turns out to be a very important tool both in cryptography and in modern mathematics, and it was invented by His Eminence Carl Friedrich Gauss for different reasons that we will encounter in future lectures. Code breaking the Caesar cipher is a quite easy task, and to do so we will use here brute force and frequency analysis. Before we dive into technical details, let us retrace the history of code breaking, and in particular the one of frequency analysis. Abu Yusuf Yaqub ibn Ishaq as-Sabah Al-Kindi was a Muslim philosopher, polymath, mathematician and musician, prominent member along with Al-Khwarizmi of Bayt-Al-Hikma, the House of Wisdom, also known as the Grand Library of Baghdad, which was the intellectual hub of the Golden Age of Islam. Al-Kindi was the first mathematician to develop frequency analysis, a code-breaking method based on analyzing the occurrence of letters in a given language using probability theory way before Cardano, Pascal, or even Fermat by almost 800 years. His Excellence recognized patterns and frequencies while studying the Holy Quran. It became an evidence to him that some words appeared more often than other words, and even better, letters appeared at some fixed frequencies as well. In his famous treatise on deciphering cryptographic messages, Al-Kindi wrote the following. In this paragraph, he describes how to cryptanalyze a specific kind of ciphers, among which the Caesar cipher. We shall discuss his idea in details with concrete examples. Notice first that frequency analysis is useless to code break the Caesar cipher. This is because there are only 25 different ways to encrypt a message, so all we have to do is to try all the keys, which is the brute force method. However, we will use it here for our educational purposes. Moreover, back in the days of Julius Caesar, his cipher was sufficient because a happy few were able to read, and even a happy fewer knew about this encryption scheme. Now consider the intercepted message that you can see here. If you know that the used language here is English, then this one-letter word, B, must refer either to an A or to an I. Now if you take a look at our table of conversions, then we see that the letter P corresponds to 15, and then the letter A corresponds to 0. So for an A to be encrypted to P, the key must have been 15. Let us now try to decrypt our message using key 15. First thing to do is to convert our letters to numbers to get what you see on the screen, and then we subtract 15 to each of the numbers to get 0, 10, 18, 14, and so on and so forth. What you see here might seem a little bit weird for you because 7 minus 15 is actually equivalent to minus 8 modulo 26, which is equivalent to 26 minus 8 actually modulo 26, and this gives us the result, which is 18 modulo 26. Now if you convert back numbers to letters to get our plain text, one sees that the message we get, at least its beginning, makes no sense. This means that our letter P here does not correspond to an A. Let us now try to see if you convert our P to an I, things make sense. If we get back to our table of conversions, we see that I corresponds to 8 and P still corresponding to 15. And to get a P from an I, one must shift the alphabet by 7. Now if you do the math and subtract 7 to our ciphertext, one gets what you see on the screen and the message "I say the spy in Paris," which makes perfect sense, although I haven't seen anyone. From this example, we see that the spacing of a message provides sensitive information about the plain text to attackers. So in order to strengthen our cipher, one can change the original spacing by regrouping letters by 3, for instance, as you can see on the screen. And now if someone intercepts our ciphertext, he has to break it without the knowledge of the length of the words. Unfortunately, this doesn't increase the security of the Caesar cipher, as we shall see in the next example. Let's consider the ciphertext that you can see on this screen. The most frequent letter in our ciphertext is the letter X, as it occurs 4 times. We know from the English language frequency analysis that the most occurring letter is the letter E, so we might assume that X here encrypts the letter E. Now we know from our table that the difference between our E and the letter X is 19, so we must subtract 19 to get the original text. So if you do the math and subtract 19 from our ciphertext, one gets what you see on the screen and the following plain text. Unfortunately, notice that this plain text means nothing. Something went wrong with our frequency analysis. Let us try a different path and suppose that our letter X here refers to the letter T. Actually, the letter T is the second most secure letter in the English language. Now we see on our table that T is 19 and X is 23, and the difference between them is 4, so we must subtract 4 to get our plain text. After subtraction, one gets the following message, which is 3 more days to attack. Our Caesar cipher is now broken, but notice that this example warns you from applying frequency analysis to short messages. Lecture 3 part 1 ends here, and we will see in future lectures how to improve the Caesar cipher. Thank you for listening.